Well, we're back. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas for Veterans in Politics. And today we have two fabulous guests. We have Larry Brown, who's the Clark County Board of County Commissioners. I believe he's representing District C. And he's also the candidate for Las Vegas mayor. And then on the 2:30, we're going to have Aaron Craner, who's the Clark County School Board Trustee for Department G. Hey, or District G, sorry. Hey, Jim, you got any rants?
Yeah, you know what? This week I do have a rant. If you haven't been watching what's been occurring in Egypt, I'm not exactly sure what planet you're on, but fairly interesting occurrences with Mubarak finally deciding to step down, which a lot of people are applauding that. Yes, he was actually a dictator, despite what our vice president said. He didn't think he was a dictator.
He was a dictator?
Yeah. And friendly to the U.S. in the fact that he kept the peace with Israel. Now, what I'm concerned about now is with Egypt, because Egypt was the largest, most stable government in the region. Now we're seeing problems popping up in Algeria. Now we're worried about Jordan. And the unfortunate thing for the United States foreign policy-wise in that is that for years we have propped up friendly dictators in the Middle East, easier to deal with a dictator than it is a democracy. But now we've got this insurgence of these people wanting democracy in the Middle East, which is great, but one of the issues that we need to address, we need to help them with, is that we have a Jeffersonian democracy. We're more of a representative democracy. We are not a pure democracy in the sense of mob rule. And right now, if you see what's going on in Egypt, while things have been fairly organized and they're calm, fairly calm right now, how is the military really going to be able to rule that country until September? Are they going to be able to set up proper elections in which the people will get the change they want and at the same time still have a government that the United States can actually deal with a volatile, you know, with Israel? We have to make sure that we maintain our alliance, strategic alliance with Israel, but at the same time, we need to make sure that we are not upsetting any of the some of the factions there in the Middle East. So we'll see what happens. The U.S. currently spends about $1.3 billion worth of aid to Egypt. Most of that's military. So let's hope that we do have advisors on the ground right now going to help them. And let's hope that Egypt gets what they deserve, which all people deserve is a democracy. But let's hope that we can help them out so that the transition is smooth and it's beneficial to Egypt and to the U.S. as well.
But don't they have a handpicked successor, that vice president?
Yeah, well, that's not going to work. I don't see him actually becoming president. What the concern is now is the Muslim Brotherhood. Were they actually behind this uprising? Will they be a part of the new government or will they won't? So there's, like President Obama said it right, this is definitely just the beginning of the transition process. It's not anywhere near the end of it.
Right. Well, let's go a little bit local now.
Okay.
You know, we have this municipal race there that's coming up.
Right.
And we have 18 people in the mayor's race.
Yes.
And, you know, it's customary for the veterans in politics to go to all candidates' functions prior to endorsement interviews.
Right.
And then once we endorse a candidate, we could only go to that particular candidate's functions. Or if we don't endorse no one, then we still go to everybody's functions.
Right.
But, you know, that these mayor candidates have been having pretty good functions. Boy, yeah. I've been eating. I've been drinking. I've been doing pretty good. I haven't been to Larry Brown's function yet. Maybe he might invite us to one of his. But just wanna give everybody a heads up that on there's no emails or press release have been sent out yet. But this is just something we just put together as far as we had a meeting on, I think it was Thursday, with a lot of the veterans and politics members. And on Thursday, March 3rd, at the Las Vegas City Council Chambers of all places, we're going to have our endorsement interviews from 1 to 5 with all the Las Vegas candidates that are running for judge and council and mayor. And on March 5th at the Marine Corps League from 12 to 5, we're going to have the Henderson candidates, North Las Vegas candidates, and Boulder City candidates. So just want everybody to mark their calendars and know that it's open to the public. And just to all the candidates out there that are listening, the Veterans in Politics cannot endorse you if you don't attend. That's so true. It's part of our bylaws. If you don't attend our function to be interviewed, there is no way we're going to be able to endorse you. So just want to put that out there. Well, right now we have Larry Brown, who's the Clark County Board of Commissioners, represent District C, and a candidate for Las Vegas City Mayor. Larry, how are you doing today, sir?
Great. Steve, Jim, good morning. Good afternoon.
Larry, could you tell us about yourself?
Well, I'll use Jim's segue as far as the Jeffersonian. back when I born and raised in the Boston area, five brothers, two sisters, small town, dad, black bag carrying pediatrician.
I thought he was going to say his dad is black.
Yeah.
I was like, wow.
And he, in that whole environment, being raised in a small town with all the siblings, those values that we grew up with, very active in student council in high school and sports, and went on to Harvard University.
You did, Harvard.
Harvard University, graduated with a degree in government. That's why the segue with the Jeffersonian. I remember studying the Jeffersonian versus the Federalists, and mm-hmm. I'll get to that in a second, as Tip O'Neill, all politics is local. But a week after I graduated from Harvard, I signed a professional baseball contract, and in 1983 came here with the first Las Vegas Stars baseball team. In between seasons, went home to my then fiance, now wife's.
What position did you play?
Pitcher.
Oh, you were a pitcher.
Pitcher, sure. I couldn't catch and I couldn't hit, but if you put a ball in my hand, I was okay.
So you have a good arm then, huh?
Quarterback the football team at Harvard and captain the baseball team. But went. My wife is from Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania, another small town, famous groundhog last week. And she moved out here. I played in '84, and we were just going to hang in Las Vegas for one winter before we headed back east where our family was. And that was 28 years ago, and three born and raised Las Vegans as our children, and got involved in politics in the Northwest. I've lived there most of my stay in Las Vegas, and just was real concerned about the lack of infrastructure and beltway and roads and parks. And I grew up with the old adage, you know, don't complain about something. If you can think and do a better job, go do it. And I've been in politics since 97.
So you were the Las Vegas City Councilman. How long did you serve?
I served 11 and a half years.
How was that?
Wonderful. I look back when we moved out. We lived in the Northwest in 86, moved a little bit further, Craig and Tanea in 92, and we've been in the same house since. And I have literally been part of the growth into the Northwest part of the valley and on the western part of the valley in the city. And three things I got involved with when I ran, and I stay by those to this day. First and foremost, the reason I got involved was open space and parks. There was nothing out there. And now, those familiar with the northwest part of the valley, we have the Betty Wills Soccer Complex, we have the Kellogg's Air Soccer Complex, the Darling Tennis Center, Lone Mountain Little League, Children's, we have the Mountain Ridge Little League, the Majestic Park, which I was at a tournament this morning. Those are all parks that I was involved with, almost 20% of the existing inventory. Secondly, the budget. I learned very quickly that unless you can control and manage and understand government budgeting, you won't get anything done. And I've always rolled up my sleeves, been referred to now as a budget hawk, fiscal conservative. And the third, and I think it's very important, is trying to continually...
But you're a Democrat. How could you be fiscally conservative?
A JFK Democrat and a Jeffersonian Democrat. Now remember how this all began. And I've always believed, as I mentioned earlier, growing up in Boston with pictures of JFK on the wall, Tip O'Neill, all politics is local, public service is an honorable profession. It truly is. And it's incumbent upon everybody that serves to make sure that we're reminded every day that that is our job, to serve. It's not to sit in the ivory tower and make decisions in a vacuum. It's to go out and serve the people you represent.
Right.
And I have lived up to that each and every day. That's what makes me a better elected official is listening to the constituents.
Commissioner, why do you think that public service, a lot of people that are in public service, specifically politicians, get such a bad rap? Because I know when I, that's what I always say to everybody too, you know, you'll sit here around this table and you'll complain all day long, but, you know, did you vote in the last election? Do you know who your county commissioner is? Do you know who your city councilman is? Do you know those things? Oh, well, they're all crooks. It doesn't matter. Why do you think so many people think that way?
Well, I don't think it's so many people. I think it's a very vocal minority that write angry letters and do the blogs and show up screaming and hollering and... But I think there's a silent majority, in, especially in Las Vegas, that know that we're working hard, know we're trying to do our best, appreciate the quality of life they've come to enjoy. Where we get in trouble, and it's like any profession, I don't care if it's radio, I don't care if it's a doctor, a professional athlete, when something goes wrong, we're all painted with the same brush. And just a few years ago, we had a lot of indictments at the county level. We had some problems at the city. And that stigma stays with you. You have, when that happens, we're all painted with the same brush, and that just makes us work harder to restore that public confidence.
So, Commissioner, I have to ask, why Las Vegas mayor? Most people, I believe Steve posed this question last week to Steve Ross, who is one of your opponents. Why, if you're, why would a commissioner who supposedly, according to John Ralston, specifically said that you basically, the seat you hold now, you are one of the most, if not the most powerful or influential board in the state. Why then would you want to run for Las Vegas mayor?
And I don't disagree with that. The authority and the responsibility of a Clark County commissioner, perhaps outside the governor, is the most powerful and one with the most authority. But to me, it's never been about the power and the authority. It's about the service. And I have been fortunate in my Ward 4 when I was at the city. I represented 120,000 people. My county commission district C, I represent 350,000. 86% of my constituency lives within the city of Las Vegas. The mayor is just an extension of that. The more people to serve. I'll hopefully be able to continue on my regional transportation commission, a regional flood, which I chair both of those, get back on the convention authority. So it's just an enhancement. And granted, the mayor's position is different because there's a pulpit there. You can do things as a mayor that you can't do as an individual commissioner and or an individual councilman. And that is, I think, a progression that has gotten me into this mayor's race.
One of the things I noticed when I was doing some research on you was that you wanted to do more development, not just if you're mayor. You would like to see development move spread from more than just the downtown area, which seems what was Mayor Goodman's, you know, pet project was downtown. What do you mean by that? What specific other areas of Las Vegas were you looking
for? Well, for sure, right now the downtown is the place that development will take place. The incentives are there, the redevelopment agency, some of the small victories that you've seen over the last few years from the East Fremont and some of those small business owners to the big announcement with Zappos. So downtown, I don't want to move away from the focus on downtown because that's where we attract businesses. But you have Centennial Hills with tremendous development opportunity. You have Summerlin, which has tremendous commercial opportunity up there. So the core is where we have to remain focused. But from a local government standpoint, the emphasis has to be on creating jobs. And we do that two ways. We do that with our capital program, public work projects, be they water, sewer, roads, parks. We have to dedicate those funds and not subsidize operations, which we've done poorly in the past, and get those public work projects on the street. And on the flip side of that coin, we have to create a business-friendly environment. And that's permitting, licensing, expedited review processes, those incentives that the RDA offers to get people that coming to Southern Nevada to choose the city of Las Vegas.
Okay, well, I have one particular intersection that has a lot of interest to me because I live so close in the area. I reside in Rancho Manor, and right on the corner of the new police station that they're building, right on the corner of Martin Luther King and Alta or Bonneville, whichever side of the road you're on there, what is the city going to do, or what is the county going to do in general, to make sure that that is not just a traffic nightmare? Because once that thing opens, I can tell you right now, just from someone who lives in the area, I just don't see the traffic infrastructure being able to support that.
And it's going to be critically important. And there's ways to mitigate that. The RTC will move in as the regional transportation and do things with the signalized lights and dedicated turns and all that. But what's going to make that corner move as it should is the Project Neon. And the Project Neon, everything east of Martin Luther King is going to become part of the interstate freeway. Now, it's there. It's designed, or well-designed. We have to find a couple $100 million to do the Project Neon. But once that happens, that'll almost be an afterthought as far as that intersection. And there are some gridlock intersections. We want to do everything possible proactively to avoid that.
Okay. Hey, Commissioner, they said there's no love in politics. In this mayor's race, the candidates, you have Councilman Ross, who you sat with at the city council. You have the mayor's wife, whom you're very good friends with the mayor. And you also now sit with Commissioner Giuliani, who's in this mayor's race. How does that strike you? I mean, run against people that you're friends with or you served with. I mean, how does that work for you? Because I know it puts us in a bad spot ourselves, because we endorsed Councilman Ross one time. We endorsed you one time. We endorsed the mayor one time. We endorsed Chris Giuliani one time. And so now we're going to have to endorse one. So we're going to have 17 people that's going to be upset with us. But you actually are running in that race. So how do you cope?
It's easy. That's what makes this country different from any other country in the world. It's democracy. And again, I go back to that vocal minority that say, you know, all politicians are this or elected officials are that. They hate each other. They backstab. I have a good relationship with all those people you mentioned. Steve Ross and I worked in the Northwest on some wonderful projects. Chris Giuliani and I sit next to each on the county commission and have a good relationship as recent as this morning. We were both interviewing with a stakeholder group and had a great conversation. The mayor and his wife I've known for well over a decade now. We can be friends. At the end of the day, in 2 months or 4 months, when this cycle is over, we hope that we remain friends. But, you know, right to the point, Steve, that's what makes democracy the best. Some of the pundits would like to say there's an anointed candidate. In fact, I was probably anointed. Steve was anointed. Chris might be anointed. Now Carolyn's anointed. And that's what the pundits say. But at the end of the day, I think good quality candidates makes for a better process, and the voters will ultimately decide. Could you ask for anything else?
You know, speaking of the Northwest, the 95 freeway going from Lake Mead all the way down to Cal Canyon, there's so much construction going on. When is all that going to be over with?
Well, the current, you know, we've been fortunate in the Northwest because we, first of all, got the NDOT's pilot program on the 95 from the Spaghetti Bowl heading northwest. We had the first HOV lane. We have two dedicated transit from Centennial Hills and from Westcliff. They're extending from Washington out to Ann Road, that HOV lane, and expanding the highway. Under construction now, you're probably going to see most of the construction during calendar year 11 and finishing up in early 2012. But it's been great, because what it's demonstrated is if we have the money to build the projects that are planned, you can see and feel the difference. And that stretch of 95, anybody that was driving it 10 years ago, and anybody that drives it today says, that's good public works. That's good taxpayer dollars for the community.
Commissioner Brown, I have one thing I've always been fascinated with, and so maybe you can clear some of this up, is the Las Vegas Visitors and Convention Authority. What is truly their benefit to Las Vegas? Because I've had two arguments now. One tells me all the wonderful things they do as far as doing advertising and promoting Las Vegas in general as a tourist destination. And then basically the other side of it is, why does it cost us so much to register our vehicles? A lot of the registration fees end up going to the Las Vegas Convention Visitors Authority. And there are some people that are rather skeptical of how effective they really have been in this economic downturn?
Well, it's a great question. Now, the one thing I would correct is that the majority of their funding comes from the casino industry. The board is a balanced board. It's represented by all the elected officials in Southern Nevada, and it has representatives of the casino industry, the NRA downtown. So there's a good balance. Their value, I think, has been obvious. It is promoting Las Vegas, and just look what's happened in the last 20 years. Would the growth have happened without the LVCVA? Possibly. But that whole campaign, as far as what happens here stays here, and the reinvestment into the tourism dollars and getting people here, the statistics are phenomenal. For every visitor that comes, you know, that trickle effect as far as what it means to the local economy is just phenomenal. So their mission is a good one. As far as how they're funded, are we diverting funds? I challenge that. I'm not real comfortable saying that we should change the funding formula. They actually had money taken away last session. Fortunately, it was used for the express lanes on the I-15 between Sahara and, you know, Tropicana. So that was a great nexus, but I think it's critically important. There's some great leadership there with Rossi Rollincart. I've been in the authority for 35 years, born and raised Las Vegas, Bishop Gorman. And the leadership that the casino industry brings, the gaming industry brings, along with the locals, it's a good board. It's a good board.
You know, Centennial Hills, I believe, has the largest foreclosure rate because it's the newest part of Las Vegas. What do you plan as mayor? As county commissioner, because you represent that area, and as mayor, what do you plan to do for that declined market?
Well, and you're right, Steve. I've lived out there since '86, and certainly further in the Northwest since '92. So I've seen it. I have a little cul-de-sac that I won a lottery in 1992. We used to have lotteries back then. And three of my houses stored each other all into foreclosure. So I've seen firsthand. We've been part of that.
So your house value has dropped.
Oh, big time. Tremendous. Now, it was inflated at that peak when everybody was buying homes and staying out, you know, nights trying to get in. So, you know, we're paying for the sins of greed. And you can certainly point fingers. There's probably a lot of agencies or entities to blame. But the bottom line is we have to let the market cleanse itself. Government can certainly go in and make sure distressed properties are not becoming nuisance to the neighborhood. They're not becoming a safety issue or a hazard issue. We can try to facilitate the processing of federal dollars to clean things up. But the market will cleanse itself. The banking industry and the realtors and those potential buyers, and the investment is coming back to Las Vegas. That free market system is going to correct itself after the falling off the cliff that we've experienced the last two or three years.
Yeah, there was a meeting. Wasn't there a big networking meeting? I believe it was at the Cox Pavilion. I forget if it was yesterday or the day before, where all the a bunch of local businesses got together, and they said that the economy is coming back. It's just going to be... It's just slow right now.
Right on. And a preview yeah. 2011 yeah. at Cox Pavilion. And Rossi Rollincart was a speaker, Jerry Aguero. And they were talking for the first time in over a year. You can feel some optimism, but it's a realistic optimism. If people are saying, you know, that sound we heard last year may have been the bottom, and we will come out. We're very resilient. And we track numbers with RTC and flood control, because flood control, for example, quarter cent sales tax is what funds the entire agency. And we've seen leveling off, and now the last 4 months now, a little bit of a trickle. What we won't see is, as hard as we fell, we will not see that climb again that we experienced 5 to 10 years ago. We will see a gradual recovery, and that's a good thing. We'll come out of it a more mature community, a smarter community, as long as we don't repeat the sins of the past. And I think there's going to be a lot of opportunity for investment. People still want to come to Las Vegas, and not just for the entertainment, but the quality of life. You guys know, we're in a great situation as far as what we have in Valley. We have Mount Charleston and Lake Mead and the Valley of Fire. There's so many wonderful things, a great and growing retirement community.
Well, Commissioner Brown, I want to thank you for coming in, and I want to wish your daughter good luck in her softball tournament in Utah.
Thank you.
Hold on. I'm not done with Commissioner Brown. The mayor's position right now is a part-time position, correct?
Currently, it is.
Right. And whoever takes control of the mayor's position, when is that, June?
It would be June, yeah.
June. It'll go to a full-time position.
Correct.
At a salary at about 130.
I've heard 120 to 130, yeah.
Right now,
correct.
It's about 54.
So no, it's up over 70.
Oh, is it over 70? So it's gonna almost double and go to the full-time position.
Correct.
Okay. You have a full-time job.
Correct.
And you're also part-time as a county commissioner. Are you going to give up your full-time job for the mayor's job?
You have to. Under the new criteria, you have to. You know, it's been interesting. And again,
I don't know if a lot of the candidates know that the mayor's position is going to change.
Not only does it change, and not only do you have a full-time commitment, but you cannot hold any outside employment. That's part of the ordinance that was passed. But I want to comment that since elected, the first 6 months in 97, I went from a $95,000 salary at the Water District down to $35,500. And I tried to make that work for 6 months. Couldn't. The mortgage companies kept sending me that monthly bill. But
from $95,000 to how much?
35 or 36, 36.
Who'd want to drop like that?
Yeah. I go back to the public service?
You know, it was like I was listening to Michael McDonald yesterday, and you know Mike.
Yes, very well.
And he was saying, I said, Mike, how come you didn't go sign up for mayor? He goes, well, $1 million deal or Las Vegas mayor? I said, oh, okay, that makes a lot of sense.
There you go. But I will say this, and it's important a lot of people realize this. Since that first six-month trial in office, I've always had a second job, not out of choice, but out of necessity. Right. I've always balanced it either working with nonprofits. I'm currently with the Las Vegas 51s baseball team, so during the season at night never conflicts with my full-time job. And that commitment I made when I ran for office, I was down there every day at the city. I'm down there every day at the county. That's the only way you can truly serve. And that's, from my perspective, the only way you're going to get things done is you have to be down there and feeling it.
And how are you going to bring jobs to the city of Las Vegas?
Two things, Steve. In the immediate, we really have to get into that budget and separate the capital side of it. 18 months ago, the county took $54 million from a capital program, which is public work projects that would have been on the streets, hiring local, ideally local workers. We took that and subsidized operations. Can't do that anymore. Dedicate the capital program and get those public work projects on the street. And they're ready. We have shovel-ready projects from roads to sewer to water to flood control. They're ready to go. There's a legislation up in Carson City as we speak that's going to create this capital program fund up to $1 billion. I'd love to see that move forward because we're not saying, okay, the money's here, let's design some projects. We have hundreds of millions of projects ready to go if we can identify that funding source. The flip side is we have to create the incentives for business to want to start in Las Vegas. And not to be repetitive, but earlier I said it, you have to expedite processing and permitting and accelerated plans checks. You have to create that environment, that culture that we want to bring business to town. And whether it's a one-man shop or a Zappos and everything in between, especially when you look at downtown, you look at that critical mass. You look at businesses and people, and then the dominoes start falling from downtown. They start falling out, and then you're in a true recovery.
So are you going to be at our endorsement interview on March 3rd at 4:15?
Lock it in.
Okay. Well, I'd like to thank you for coming on the show, Commissioner Brown. And could we have your point of contact?
LarryBrownForMayor.com. And you can certainly reach me through that, or I'll be out in the community a whole bunch next couple months. Good.
Well, that's Larry Brown, who's the Clark County Commissioner, represent District C, and the mayor candidate for City of Las Vegas. Don't go away, folks. We're going to have Aaron Craner, who's a Clark County School Board trustee representing District G. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas for Veterans of Politics.
This public service announcement is brought to you by Veterans in Politics International. The Veterans in Politics mission is to teach, educate, organize, and awaken our veterans and their families to select, support, and vote intelligently for a better world and to protect ourselves from our own governments and a culture of corruption and to be the political voice for those and other groups that do not have one.
There are too many homeless veterans and more help is needed from the VA. Every veteran service organization post should adopt a local homeless veteran.
The funding of VA medical centers is inadequate and building a VA hospital in Southern Nevada is moving at a slow pace. The budget has been flatlined for too many years. The VA is too quick to deny claims and too slow to help veterans gather records in support of claims.
Local politicians ignore veterans and their issues. They perceive a lack of organization among their local veterans and that it won't hurt them at election time. Veterans too often vote party, not veteran issues. All veterans should vote in every election.
The news media give an adequate coverage to veteran issues and events. You must send letters to the editor and voice this concern.
Please contact your members of Congress and Senate and urge them to co-sponsor key legislation in supporting our veterans.
Please support veterans in politics. And to get more information, go to www.veteransinpolitics.com.
Americans have been fooled by politicians about illegal immigration. They make you think that if you bring up this topic, you are a racist. Did you know that America is the only country on this planet that does not enforce its federal immigration laws? For the fear of being called a racist, I am for legal immigration. I was born on the island of Jamaica, became an American citizen, served 12 years in the U.S. military, served in Desert Storm, and received a Presidential Unit Citation, National Defense Medal, and Marine Corps Commendation. Our immigration laws serve a purpose. I understand that this country was founded on immigration, but there is a wrong way and a right way. I'm here to tell you that illegal immigration is breaking our federal laws. Why don't you call me a racist? This is Steve Sansom.
What are you doing online?
I'm checking out the belly dance class we took last week.
Where's it at?
TakeBackYourBelly.com.
That's right.
We worked our arms.
We worked our abs.
We worked so hard and had a blast.
No matter what, your shape or size, come belly dance, you'll be surprised.
For class schedule and location, log on to TakeBackYourBelly.com or call 219-3151.
Are you a business owner struggling during these economic times? Please listen up. How would you like to put your business and services in front of every resident and business in the Las Vegas Valley for less than a penny per home? Yes, that's right. I said less than 1 cent per home and business. And how would you like to have a dynamic and exciting online presence with the major search engines? How about an online video for your business and a fully optimized website with absolutely no setup fee? Hi, my name is George. If you are interested in these and other services that can make your phone ring with clients and prospects, then call me at 702-296-8394. Just call George at 702-296-8394. Thank you.
Well, we are back. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas with Veterans in Politics. What was that about Larry Brown?
One question I forgot to ask the commissioner I spaced was, I'm just curious to see, he was, when I was reading on him, they said that he is the most quiet member on the Clark County Commission.
He's reserved.
So I'm thinking here, and that's the impression I got from him, even with the interview, and now I'm thinking he's going to replace Oscar Goodman?
Well, I guess, in theory, nobody could replace Oscar Goodman.
This is true. No one could really replace anybody, No. That's just one question I asked him. I was impressed with his answers, though.
He's a sharp guy.
Yeah, he's well-informed, for sure.
Well, let's talk to Aaron Kringer, who's the Clark County School Board Trustee, representing District G. How you doing, Aaron?
Great, Steve. Thanks for letting me come on the show today.
Not a problem, man. Could you give us a, tell us about yourself.
Well, I'm a brand new school board member on a fairly brand new board. We're seven members of the Board of Trustees for the school board. I represent the east side of town, District G, and we've got three of us are brand new, and three people are still in their first term, and then there's just one member of the school board who's actually completed one term. So brand new school board, brand new superintendent, lots of energy.
Well, One of your colleagues, Caroline Edwards, said that you were a numbers guru. And I wanted to know what you think about Governor Brian Sandoval's state of the state address.
Well, I do love numbers. I think that's where we get familiar what we've got to do, where we're starting from, and what we've got to do with our reform efforts. So I do love them, and I'm very encouraged that this governor apparently and is showing in every way that education's a priority for him. So it's exciting. It's an exciting time to be in Nevada when people are paying attention to it.
Do you agree with his statement when he says education is broken in the state?
No.
You don't agree with that?
Nope.
Why is that?
I'm actually rather offended by that statement.
How so?
Because I am personally acquainted with going on hundreds of people now who have done for my children, my four children in the public school system, things that I couldn't do for them. As much as my husband and I are devoted to our kids and our lives are centered around them, the people in their schools have done things for them that are beyond what we could offer.
Did you send him a letter saying that that statement is false?
No, I did not. I actually feel like supporting the governor's focus on education is a great idea. I'm thrilled that education is becoming number one in Nevada right now. It needs to be.
So, Aaron, now that you're on the school board, what has been one of the biggest, when you go into a job, everybody goes in having some kind of preconceived notions as to what the job entails or what the day-to-day operations of that job are going to be. What's been one of the things that you like the most about your new position, and what's one of the things that you don't like so much?
Well, I'll tell you that the biggest surprise for me, I went into it thinking that I was going to have to be more of a fighter, and I have found that the new superintendent is already starting all the things that I thought we'd be fighting for over the next few years, and so one of the things I'm most excited about is the swiftness with which he's effecting change and raising the level of professionalism and working for getting those resources back into the schools and how much he values the individuals that look the kids in the eye every day as number one.
What do you think about the new superintendent? And I'm going to call him to come on the show in the near future. I'm trying to get rid of all these municipal elections out the way. But what do you think about him? How does he grab you?
I'm sold.
You're sold. And what sold you?
Well, originally, I watched the search process very closely. I was a candidate at the time, and then the end of it took place, after I'd been elected. But I'd won the election, but I wasn't sworn in yet, of course. And so I've watched very closely. I attended the interviews that he had, and also when they brought the finalists to speak with community members and do question and answer. And the first thing that impressed me about him at that stage was his genuine respect for every different audience that they put him in front of. They sat him down with students. They sat him down with parents, some more kind and enthusiastic parents, and also some parents that had a lot of criticisms and concerns. They sat him down with elected officials and business leaders and just a variety of different audiences, and I was there. I made it a point to go and watch every time, and there was a genuine, respectful dialogue in every single setting. He treated nobody as lesser, and I think it's a part of him to effect education reform with us as a community.
You're a mother, right, Aaron?
I am. Four children.
And now you're a Clark County School Trustee, I'm sure you've been in the school district for quite some time now, right?
You mean just really involved? Yes, right. As a volunteer. Yeah, okay. At every level, even the state level, state honor code, committees, things like that.
Well, did you hear on the news that there were several teenagers that had pornographic material on their cell phones in Pahrump? They're like 13 years old. And apparently another 13-year-old female texted to the 13-year-old boy, and he's showing a bunch of his 13-year-old friends on the school bus. How do you feel about 12, 13-year-old kids. Do you feel that they should be tried for something like that, as displaying pornographic materials on their phone? They should be tried?
Well, to answer the first part of that question, I actually hadn't heard about that specific
incident. It was in Pahrump this week.
Okay. Nationwide, it's a really a big problem right now. Cyberbullying, cyber texting, or, you know, texting pornographic materials. And in fact, today, the Digital Directions, which is a national magazine about school technology, that's the front page story. It just landed on the kitchen desk today. It's a real serious issue. And I guess from my end of it as a trustee, the end of it that I'm concerned about is preventing it and putting systems in place where we can keep that from being something that becomes part of the school culture.
But do you think a 12, 13-year-old should be arrested for something like that?
You know, I haven't even given any thought to what to do with that end of the problem. The prevention end is really where I'm focused.
Or should the parents be blamed for it?
Same answer. Once it's happening, I think from my end of it, what I want as a parent is I want it to stop in the schools and not be part of what's going on in the schools. And as a trustee, I want to say, okay, what can we do at the policy level and at the big picture level to make that not something that's going on?
Right.
So, Aaron, the question I had, since you're a numbers person and so am I, and I'm a little more, I tend to focus a little more on the legislative part of it. You guys at the school district, are you currently operating under the budget they passed in 2009? Is that the one you guys are under now?
Right. Yeah.
Well, the reason why I ask is because I want to know what kind of what relationship would you like to see between the legislature and you guys as far as the budget and how exactly it's going to affect education?
Well, the way it's set up right now, there's what's called the distributive school account, which is that's the per pupil allocation. It's different for every district. It's based on formula. And it's actually quite a good system, except for one thing. If the projections come in such a way that the state, the local school district revenue sources exceed the projections that the state had, those excesses from that local area that those local taxpayers have paid, so like here in Clark County, for instance, those are back to the state. They aren't held as an education resource necessarily, even though their education-based tax is the part of the property tax that's for education, the part of, you know, local school support tax, the part of the governmental services tax that's for education. Those revert back into the state's general pot of money. And were, had that been taken care of a few years ago and held as education dollars, right, we wouldn't have an education deficit right now. We wouldn't be looking at shortfalls right now. We'd have a reserve that we would be drawing upon.
Is there any plans to address that in this legislative session coming up?
The climate we're in right now is a budget crisis.
Right.
So what to do with the excess isn't really the question. Yeah. Right now.
Yeah. So once they do pass a budget, and they will eventually pass a budget, it'll get done.
Right.
Like
yeah.
Does.
And the budget will contain what the DSA is going to be.
Right.
And then we have to take that as our givens as a board of trustees and work with the school district staff to decide, okay, how are we going to operate within the context of those limits, those financial limits that are set by the legislature.
So that will affect you guys this upcoming school year, correct?
Right now, and actually on Thursday, we're having our first special budget meeting to kind of get a handle on what we're looking at in terms of a shortfall. We are looking at a shortfall and what some of our strategies might be. The interesting thing is that by law, we have to get our budget settled upon before the legislature has to get our budget settled upon. So we have to sort of plan for the worst case scenario and make sure that we're going to be able to have a balanced budget. And then we kind of wait and see what we end up with from the legislature. And then after that, we can amend the budget. The real tough part of that is that in order to prepare to have the schools staffed next fall, that process begins March, April, May. And so we are looking at possibly people being out of a job as of next fall and finding that out this spring, and then waiting to see if that's really what the legislature is going to leave us with.
Is there any way that could be changed? I mean, would it? Would we have to... is that a part of the Nevada Constitution?
Well, the fact that we need to submit a budget...
that just doesn't
The timeline... Well, and part of it's just reality, because in order to plan for the school year, you've got to be able to have your staff in place. Right. You don't want to be hiring people while kids are sitting in the classroom next fall and have them have to change teachers or have a substitute for part of the year, et cetera, et cetera. So part of it's just the reality of, you know, revenues come in, decisions get made. The legislature likes to wait for that May 1st Economic Forum projection before they really get down to the details. And that's, you know, that's just reality. We need to operate within the context of our givens, I guess.
Have you had any communication with any legislature member of the legislature since you've been on the school board?
Oh yeah. Well, lots of us. You know, we term limits kicked in for the school board and for the legislature a couple years ago. Right. So, lots of us have been brand new first time candidates together for the last couple years.
Right.
So I've been interacting with some of my fellow freshman elected officials, yes.
Okay.
As a trustee, how could you improve upon school safety? Or is that an issue in the school district?
Well, it is an issue, and I'm actually really glad that we have in place what we do have in place. You brought up the cyber bullying and that sort of problem, and we're fortunate to actually have in the employment of the school police on the school district the Valley's expert on, you know, electronic forensics, if you want to say, you know, being able to trace back in what's been going on in a cell phone history, computer use history, and things like that. I think that's a big part of it, is that we need to be in front of that trend with the cyberbullying and the opportunity that someone has to start a rumor by text, which of course is under the radar of the adults on the campus.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's probably our primary issue right now, is trying to be in front of that and understand what we can put in place to make sure we're in front of that trend and nipping it in the bud. And then of course I personally think that one of the most important things we do is that we have the campus security monitors and the campus policemen who are assigned to the campus. And so they have the opportunity to establish a relationship and a rapport with the students and have that interpersonal interaction where they know they're there, they know they can go to them, they know they can tell them if they see some sign of, you know, gang activity or some sign of a threat.
How many schools do you have in your district?
43 in District G.
How many high schools?
We've got Sunrise Mountain, El Dorado, Chaparral, the East Career Technical, brand new one, Las Vegas High School, Del Sol, and Southeast Career and Tech.
Does any of them have any metal detectors?
No.
How about ROTC? Any ROTC programs in any of those schools?
I believe we do have a couple of ROTCs on our side of town. But I'm not going to say it over the mic which ones I think they are, because I'm not totally sure. Chaparral, I know the ROTC instructor there. I'm not sure about the other high schools.
How do you see yourself as a trustee to get more parents involved in the school system?
Well, I think one of the things that I can do personally is just make sure that I'm communicating and letting people know what the topics are that are coming up, what the decisions are that we're facing at the time. You know, the cyberbullying, for example, the budget cuts, what will our priorities be, other topics that come up. If I can make sure that they understand in time to think it over a little bit and give me some feedback, then we can have that interaction at the policy level. And then at the school level, it's really a matter of the climate, the professionalism, treating people well when they come in to give you a hand.
So, Aaron, I'm glad you brought that up, because that actually leads into my next question. As far as priorities go, we're gonna see cuts somewhere. We know how, for lack of a better term, how bad a shape the state is budget-wise. What? How do you guys prioritize cuts? Because, you know, lots of times people tend to want to go after music programs, sports usually seem to be the first programs to get cut. What have you guys sat down and came up with priorities for this year? What might need to go?
Well, I will tell you that on Thursday, actually, as I mentioned, we're going to have a special budget meeting, and it's really the kind of preliminary big picture discussion. I don't know that we've I don't really expect us to take a priority of cuts approach so much as a priority of what to have in place. And the direction that the new superintendent is going in and that I'm absolutely on board with is that resources end up at the school level. And by resources, we really mean people. That's really what the school district budget is all about. And so we need to have that talent at the school site, looking the students in the eye and responding to those dynamic needs of the students and helping them prepare for their future.
Is this meeting on Thursday open to the public, or is this
a closed meeting? Yes, it's a posted open board meeting in the boardroom.
Okay.
And Thursday morning at 8.
Thursday morning at 8. And what's the location?
That's at 2832 East Flamingo, which is the boardroom.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's 8 o'clock in the morning. You know, I don't get up that early.
It's 8:30, Steve. You can do it.
8:30. Wow.
I'll be getting off. I can make it.
Anything that you want to bring up, Aaron? As far
well,
as
well, since you mentioned numbers, I thought we were going to talk about the new rankings. Quality Counts just
came
out.
Let's do it.
That's our Nevada. You know, we'll be talking about it all year. It gives us a starting point. Education Week is the magazine that publishes the Quality Counts numbers, and Nevada does rank 51st if you count DC in what they call chance for success.
51st out of how many?
50 states plus DC.
So we rank at the bottom?
We rank the bottom. Now, what Chance for Success comprises is it includes K-12 achievement, and it also factors in family income, parent education, parent employment, linguistic integration, meaning fluency in English, and preschool participation. We are almost or completely last in preschool. We're last in preschool participation. We're one of very few states where fewer than 90% of the parents are fluent in English. And we are dead last in parent educational attendance or attainment, the percent of parents that have a college degree. If you take those factors out, then you're just talking K-12 achievement. We're 39th this year. And so once you remove those external factors that affect a child's chance for success and just look at the schools, we're 39th. So that's sort of our starting point as we, you know, as trustees, that's basically where we're focusing is, okay, let's look at what's going on inside the schools, the student experience. We're starting from 39th, and that's where we're moving up from. One of the most interesting things to me, and I guess causes for hope on that K-12 was our advanced placement. We're 19th in the nation for advanced placement achievement, which is measured the way that Education Week gives us that number is they take for every 100 students in grade 11 or 12, how many score 3, 4, or 5 on the AP test. So how many AP tests were passed so that they're going into college with college credit under their belts. And we have one of the greatest gains in AP test placement. And I would just guess that that may be what's brought us up, is that one factor. We've had such good gains in the advanced placement area that it's, I think it's bringing Nevada up overall.
What is your overall opinion of AP? Because I was in AP classes, and honestly, I think it did help prepare me for college, but that's before we actually started getting college credits for them. And honestly, I thought I would just got more work. Homework rather than actually quality.
I'll definitely agree with you that an advanced placement course is more work. In our house, we've got two high school students, and between them, there's 5 AP classes going on right now, and it's definitely more work.
Yeah. Aaron, do you agree with the philosophy that new businesses won't come to Las Vegas from other states because of the uneducated workforce we have here?
I think that's a huge factor. I think we also need to look at our healthcare system. Education and healthcare, I think both of them need to come up.
So, Aaron, after you and this new school board, after you fix education, then are you going to – so the next step for you then, are you going to be able to go up to Carson City and fix this budget?
You know, I personally, all I want is a school board. I've just felt like this was what I was meant to do, honestly, and I absolutely love it. It fills me with energy. The more I put into it, the more energy I have to put into it.
How do you get along with everybody on the board?
I think we're a great team. We're new, relatively new, very high energy. Several people have told me that the school board meetings are different now.
Who's the new chair, by the way?
Carolyn Edwards.
Carolyn
She's
Edwards.
The one so member the of the school chair? Board that's in her second term. The rest of us are all in our first term.
Who's the vice chair?
Vice chair is Linda Young, and the clerk is Deanna Wright.
Okay, very cool. Well, Aaron, thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you, Steve.
Could we have your point of contact?
How to get in touch with me?
Yeah. Right.
Sure. Just send me an email at erincranor@gmail.com. ErinCranor at gmail.
The POC is a military term.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
Well, that was Aaron Craner, the Clark County School Board trustee, representing District G. You have anything else, Jim?
No, just I like the fact that we got someone with so much energy on the school board.
That's great.
One of an energetic team.
This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas with Veterans in Politics. Until next week.